All right, in this problem, we're going to show how to use Levenspiel or reciprocal rate plots to solve for the volume that's required in CSTR and PFR reactors, or the required batch time if we're dealing with a constant volume batch reactor. Okay, we're going to start by considering a CSTR, and we'll write a material balance for this CSTR, where we feed in components A, B, might have other components, and then we'll expect to react our reactants A and B and form some products. Now, what, as a reminder, what helps us in writing material balances for CSTRs is that we have a well-mixed tank and the conditions everywhere in the tank are uniform. So the rate of reaction is uniform everywhere in the tank, temperature, concentration, and so forth. We'll write a material balance of the form N minus out plus generation equals accumulation. And we'll write this in terms of the component A, so we have an inlet flow rate of A, FA naught, and an outlet flow rate, FA, and so our N minus out is FA naught minus FA. Our rate of generation is our rate per unit volume, R sub A, times the volume of the reactor. And then at steady state, our accumulation term is equal to zero. We can now use the definition of conversion, that it's equal for a flow reactor to FA naught minus FA over FA naught, so the amount reacted over the amount fed of component A. And this allows us to simplify the above expression to FA naught X is equal to negative RA times V. And we can rearrange things a little bit more into a different form, where the volume divided by FA naught is equal to the conversion times the reciprocal rate of consumption of A, the negative of the rate of generation, which is the rate of consumption. Okay, we see that we can determine the volume, which is often what we want to solve for, in terms of the conversion and then the reciprocal rate multiplied together. The reciprocal rate we're going to need to get from experimental data, and sometimes we actually plot that experimental data in terms of the conversion if we're at a fixed temperature, for example. And so we could plot just the rate versus conversion, but it's often convenient, because of the form of this equation, to plot the reciprocal rate as a function of conversion. And so that plot will often look something like this, that the rate tends to go down as we convert more and more of our products, because there will be more and more of our reactants to products, because there are fewer reactants to react. Okay, and so therefore the reciprocal rate actually goes up with conversion. If we take 1 over that rate that's decreasing with conversion, then we get a function that's increasing with conversion. And here we're assuming that we have constant temperature because the reaction rate, of course, is also a very strong function of temperature. And so if we want to size a CSTR, we know that we need the conversion times the reciprocal reaction rate. And that's basically defined by the area of the rectangle that we just drew with the dashed line. And it's the reciprocal reaction rate, which is the length of the side of the rectangle. Then the length of the base of the rectangle is the conversion that's achieved in the reactor. All right, and this works because the reciprocal reaction rate is uniform everywhere within the CSTR. And we'll see that things are different when we look at a tubular reactor. And so we'll just draw that the volume divided by the inlet flow rate of A is equal to the area of that rectangle when we plotted up our experimental data in terms of the reciprocal rate versus conversion of component A. All right, this was for a CSTR. Let's take a look at a PFR or a tubular reactor. We'll have the same form for the material balance, except that it's going to be in terms, as we've shown before, of an integral function, where we get dx over negative RA integrated from 0 to the final conversion in the reactor. And so the reciprocal reaction rate here changes down the length of the reactor because the reactor is not perfectly mixed down the entire length of the reactor. And so we have to integrate the reciprocal reaction rate over dx. And it's not at a fixed value as it is for the CSTR. And so we can look at this graphically as the area under the curve for this reciprocal reaction rate plot evaluated from zero conversion up to the final conversion. And we see that what's typical, although not always observed to be the case, is that that area is less than the area associated with the CSTR. And therefore, the volume required for a PFR to achieve a given conversion is usually less than the volume required for a CSTR. All right, so the CSTR is, again, the area of the rectangle. The PFR is the area under the curve. And this difference is a consequence of the fact that the reaction rate is uniform everywhere in a CSTR and varies down the length of a PFR. Now, we can also use the same form of experimental data to evaluate the required time for a constant volume batch reactor system. We can again do a material balance on A, which we've shown previously in terms of conversion. And it can be written in this fashion for a batch reactor, that we have actually an accumulation term shown on the left and no inlet or outlet terms because it's a batch reaction system, but we have a net generation term on the right. We can rearrange our terms a little bit and put it into an integral form. And we get the expression shown here where, again, we get this integral of 1 over the reaction rate, or in other words, the reciprocal reaction rate times dx. This looks exactly the same, as you'll notice, as a PFR on the right-hand side. And so if we can evaluate the area under the curve on a Levenspiel plot, then we can evaluate the required batch time. All right, for a constant volume batch reaction system, we'll usually write this Na naught over V as a Ca. And then, again, we can use the batch time divided by the concentration, inlet concentration, or beginning concentration, Ca, is equal to that area under the curve.